great Hanbalite scholars are great Sufi masters, great awliya, great men of Allah. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal himself believed in seeking the barakah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in visiting the grave of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, believed in the weak hadith being valid proofs in the field of Sharia, and in the narration of the mu'jizat and the fada'il. Unlike modern Hanbalites, even back to 50 years ago, 70 years ago, the greatest Hanbalite scholars in Syria were great Sufis.
Yeah.
And many of them were Shadhilis, for example. So followers, true followers of these four madhabs, majority of the ummah. I would say to add to this, here you could filter who's a Hanafi, who's a Hanbali. They should be at the same time followers of Al-Imam Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari or Al-Imam Abu Mansur al-Maturidi in their explanation of Aqidah. Now we follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in everything.
Of course.
In our fiqh, in our Aqidah, we follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But in fiqh, we follow his way of ibadah as presented to us and interpreted to us
by
these imams.
Yes.
And in Aqidah, we follow the Aqidah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but as presented to us, explained to us by Imam Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari and Imam Abu Mansur al-Maturidi. Both of them came in a dark time where Ahl al-Sunnah were oppressed, and they advocated the doctrine of Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. I would say, for example, in the sub-Indian continent, if you love Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan, you're from Ahl al-Sunnah
wal-Jama'ah.
I would say, for example, in the Middle East and North Africa, if you love Sheikh Yusuf al-Nabhani, you are from Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. If you're against an Imam Sheikh Yusuf al-Nabhani, you're against Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. You're familiar with the Imam Sheikh Yusuf al-Nabhani, the best lover of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Middle East, who authored dozens of books in praise of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in prayers on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in description of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and on and on and on. So these people can distinguish.
Of course.
By following them, we know who we are, and by attacking them or criticizing them, we know who the other party is.
Of course.
That is probably in a nutshell defined for our modern viewers. If we go back in history, for example, anyone who criticizes Imam Ghazali, put a question mark in front of him, he doesn't belong to Ahl al-Sunnah.
Any scholarly personality from the Indo-Pak subcontinent that you personally have been inspired by, or you studied, or you...
Well, definitely, the Muslim Ummah is one body. And scholars from the East and the West of Ahlul Sunnah belong to one tree.
Subhanallah.
Now it has many branches, but we are connected to each other exactly like tissues belonging to one body. In the sub-Indian continent, I believe the most famous of all scholars in modern times is the great Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan of Bareilly.
Subhanallah.
Who was, I would consider, the mujaddid of Islam in the sub-Indian continent.
Subhanallah.
Now, to your surprise, I heard of Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan from when I was a little boy in Damascus.
That was actually one of the questions. Is Sheikh Ahmad Ridha linked to any of your teachers or your scholars?
Definitely. I read about Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan in the famous work of Sayyid Abdul Hayy al-Kattani, Fihris al-Fahris.
Subhanallah.
Because Sayyid Abdul Hayy al-Kattani took ijazah from Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan.
Subhanallah.
And also some years ago, I believe approximately 10 years ago, I read in the Rihla of Sayyid Muhammad al-Zamzami al-Kattani. I got a copy of it, a manuscript, in 1997. And then it was published, or parts of it were published, in Dirasat al-Islamiyya magazine in Pakistan.
Okay,
and he mentions the encounters between his father, the great muhaddith of al-Maghrib, Sayyid Muhammad ibn Ja'far al-Kattani, the father of my teacher and my father's teacher, Sayyid Muhammad al-Makki al-Kattani. The encounters between Sayyid Muhammad ibn Ja'far al-Kattani and Sayyid Ahmad Ridha Khan of Bareilly in al-Madinah al-Munawwara.
Subhanallah.
And he refers to his book Ad-Dawla al-Makkiyya on the knowledge of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, and how vast it is, and how he was given the knowledge of everything.
Subhanallah.
And Sayyid Muhammad ibn Ja'far al-Kattani wrote a book on the same subject in three volumes called Jila'u al-Qulubi min al-Asda'i al-Ghayniyya fi Ihatatihi sallallahu alayhi wa sallama bil-Ulumi al-Kawniyya.
Subhanallah.
A three volume work which was published recently in Egypt. So my first encounters with Sayyid Ahmad Ridha Khan were in my father's library.
Subhanallah.
Because he had a small work, very tiny but of great significance, called Al-Mujmal Al-Mu'addid لتأليف المجدد. That was an index of the books which Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan, رحمه الله تعالى ورضي عنه, authored and was published during his lifetime in India, in the Indian writing style, lithography. And it has sections on his books in Arabic, in Urdu, in Persian, and books on tafsir, books on ulum al-Qur'an, ulum al-fiqh, ulum al-hadith, and so on. So these are the early encounters with Shaykh Ahmad Ridha Khan, rahimahullah ta'ala, wa radiya anhu. And later on, I learned more and more about his works, and got the first book of his I got was Ad-Dawla al-Makkiyya, bil-maddati al-ghaybiyya, and I read it twice. And benefited from it a lot, and so enjoyed reading it, and one of the best works on this subject. So I referred now to the book of Sayyid Muhammad bin Ja'far al-Kattani. It's a vast work, a very elaborate work, that adds also a lot of information on the same subject. I read several of his works later on, and was very deeply affected by reading his book which was translated into the English language. I was given actually 6 months ago as a gift. One of the brothers gave me the first volume of Al-Mulfuzat in English. And I was reading it in Birmingham while I was a guest of the Muslim community there. And this is like before Fajr time. And I was in a state of rapture reading his fatwas, reading his comments on the awliya, reading I was in rapture. I went into a state of takbir, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, for having such a scholar defending, advocating the doctrine of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah so strongly, having this deep love of the awliya and the ulama. I feel, wallahi, to be honest, I feel like the Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan and our great shaykhs and their shaykhs in Damascus have drunk from the same river.
Subhanallah.
From the same cup even.
Subhanallah.
This is what we were taught about the nur of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, about our connection and imagining, visualizing our presence in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, about being firm, who is Ahl Sunnah and who is a deviator, about many issues. And I find the Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan at that early time really predicted a lot of what's going on now.
Yeah.
And wanted to put an end. Even he spoke about, for example, multi-faith dialogue in that Al-Malfuzat. I was very happy to read this as early as that time, writing and warning of it, warning of it, how it is going now.
Yes.
Because multi-faith dialogue for us is da'wah, is a way of da'wah, presenting Islam or showing people the true nature of Islam, rather than making concessions about our deen as people are doing now. So I went to bed after like a duha time, after sunrise sometime, and I saw Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan in my dream. And that was like the peak. I was in rapture, in joy, in, I said, Subhanallah. It happened to me several times. I read about scholars, or I read their books, or make mention of them, or I narrate their isnads, and then I see them in my dreams. But about Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan, it was like the top of joy seeing him. And I believe Muslims in the sub-Indian continent were given this great bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by having this scholar who was a great scholar on fiqh, a great scholar on hadith, a great scholar on the Arabic language, a great poet himself. I think he mastered every discipline.
Alhamdulillah.
And his books show the level of his knowledge.
And I would add to that, a great faqih, if you see the works that the Shaykh has compiled in the subject of fiqh.
Exactly.
It's amazing. You think to yourself that, subhanallah.
One of his teachers is very famous in the isnads of the people of Al-Sham. Is Mawlana Fadlur Rahman Ibn Hallullah Al-Kunj Murad Abadi.
Yes.
Who died year 1314. And I was told that Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan met him and took his ijaza, and Mawlana Fadlu al-Rahman took his turban and put it on the head of the Mawlana Imam Ahmad Ridha Khan.
Subhanallah.
Mawlana Fadlu al-Rahman is the teacher of the teacher of our teachers.
Subhanallah. So there's that very tight and a very link between the scholars.
Ahlul Sunnah are one body, wherever you go.